You know that we're actually shooting.
Fuck. Hello.
So you're back at this.
Yes, here we are.
it's easier this year because you only have one movie instead of two movies, right?
Yes. But yeah, here we are again.
So is Frost Nixon different because you spent so much time with it as a play before you got to the movie part, or?
That was, I mean, we all did. I mean, Frank and Michael did it, 340 times. And and yeah, I feel like I've been with it for a very long time. And what was interesting, I had a conversation with Ron just shortly before I came, and and my view of it changes all the time. It's organic. So even the lovely thing about a play is you can keep changing a play. But even with the film, my view of it, I mean, for example, when we started, I was quite determined that it wasn't political. I thought it was just an entertainment. And I somewhat, to my shame, I think, because now I've started to reappraise it, and I do think it's political. I mean, you know, since the election,
right,
and since all this very laudable bipartisan, you know, the stretching of hand to forgive, to heal, and my enemies are now my friends, and you know, what Obama's doing, you just hope that in that spirit of goodwill that one doesn't forgive too quickly. And therefore, a film about calling to account suddenly does feel more political than it did before. So, so in that sense, I keep changing my view about what it is. And
did you have to battle with people? Did you have arguments about whether it was political or not, or did it?
No, to my shame, I sort of led the charge, saying, I don't think it's political. Partly because I couldn't make any claim for it being a Bush metaphor.
Right.
When I first had the idea to write it in 1993, you know, so or 1994, that would have been prescience of a spooky kind, you know. Cause I don't even think he was governor of Texas at that point, so let alone thinking about the presidency. But obviously, when the play was on, and you could start to hear the first ripples about how an audience was reading it. By this point, it was 2004. Then it was sort of, you know, undeniable, unmistakable, and there were some times where I went to the play and pulled references out, and then other times I went in and planted a few things in, you know, just so that they became a little bit more poignant. And I kept thinking, I'll be able to change that as time evolves, you know, and as the play becomes a metaphor for different things being held to account.
Right.
You can go in and perhaps, I mean, for example, if I was writing it now. I'm sure I would have had something to say, or tried to find something to say, about Nixon's record on the economy. But, you know, that was then, and Iraq was the story that dominated everything.
So is there a change, big change, between London and New York with the play?
No, there was no time. I mean, we just dashed across. I mean, this thing just, you know, I mean this, you know, there's no, I'm not saying this disingenuously. My highest hopes for Frost Nixon were that it should be a play performed in a pub theatre somewhere. And, you know, I had no confidence in it or for it.
Because I'm
not an established playwright, and this was me really taking a risk and thinking to myself, I want to write a play, I want to see how that feels. And I was completely unmotivated by financial gain, and I'm a father, you know, so obviously you have to always think about, I've got four kids, so, you know, earning for children is kind of, you know, and to take 6 months off with no earnings whatsoever was difficult at that time, you know. And and Frank Langella, when he signed up from New York, he told his friends, I'll be back in 6 weeks. I mean, you know.
Well, what was it? I mean, did it evolve as you guys were going through rehearsals with Grandage in London? And I mean, did it become a different play? Did it become a play that was more audience friendly, or?
No, that came, funnily enough, that came before, I think, even Grandage's rehearsals, which I was hardly present for. I mean, he very much likes to be on his own with the actors. It came, the way I wrote it was, I did a draft. Mm-hmm. I did all the research. I went out and met everybody, and then I did a draft. I wrote it in Austria, actually, in the mountains. Mm-hmm. And then we did some readings, table readings. Mm-hmm. And it was a really good English actor, a guy called Alex Jennings, who played Nixon. Doesn't look anything like Nixon. Could never have really played Nixon.
Right.
But in his readings, very intelligent reader. Uh-huh. I saw a playfulness, and actually we were all laughing as he was toying with Frost, mm-hmm. and intellectually dominating mm-hmm. him, and the way in which he was playing cat and mouse with him. Mm-hmm. That made me write him probably much more mischievously than Nixon ever was. Hmm. I don't know that that's necessarily inaccurate, but it was so delightful and so spoke to the power balance or mm-hmm. imbalance between them. And that came entirely out of the reading. That came from just hearing that. And so I think, it's made me much more. I do table readings whenever I can now.
Mm-hmm. Was that? Have you had the issue of what is real, and what is not real? And you almost all of your work is historically based, on some level. And we've certainly seen big drama around W coming out, mm-hmm. so quickly during an administration. Does that matter a lot to you, or is that something you're terribly sensitive to hearing about or being poked at about? Or
no, I mean it's a really reasonable, it's the obvious question to ask, and also the responsibility of that, and because especially when people are still alive and still in office.
Can you believe they even tried that with W?
Here's the thing. For me, on the one hand I was incredibly impressed because I love to see a film move that quickly. Mm. And that's what we would call state of the nation. It's sort of a function generally fulfilled by a television play in England. Mm-hmm. Historically, that's what, it would have been a play for today.
Right.
And I've never seen cinema move that quickly. So in that sense, I was incredibly impressed. Mm-hmm. Having said that, perhaps, I would have preferred to have waited a little bit, because then with some distance, you can look at the period slightly differently. Mm-hmm. And certainly in the case of the deal, that was 10 years after it happened, and the Queen was 10 years after, and Frost Nixon obviously many years. And in this last one that I want to write about special relationship, that's about Blair and Clinton. That also, that's a 10-year gap.
Well, even something like the Queen, you can't really imagine what it really meant as it was happening. I think that's right.
All the journalists were, because there was a wonderful book called After Diana, which was written in the 2 months after Diana's death, and really good writers and respected academics, and they were all writing in this book, and it was fantastically interesting to read, but it was very confused. I mean, people were very emotional. They were almost tripping. The history was moving so fast, and the events were so powerful, and the country was in such distress. Mm-hmm. You could see, even in this writing, even in academic writing, the prose was vibrating. It wasn't calm. Mm-hmm. And you felt people were almost too hysterical to make a judgment, but that didn't mean it wasn't interesting.
Right.
And that's just a different... just a different route, I suppose.
Yeah, I think that's what's happening with the internet these days. With the, even just within journalism, the difference between trying to get something out first and quick and now, and trying to beat everybody else, and the perspective of even 24 hours that something like the New York Times would take, or the Wall Street Journal, the LA Times, is slowly slipping away.
And fact checking, which takes time, takes a lot of time. I'm very impressed every time I. I've had to deal with American journalists, the rigor with which, particularly the New Yorker and Newsweek and New York Times, the rigor with which people ring back, they fact check again, mm-hmm. and that's nothing like that ever happens in England.
But it's usually what kind of shirt you're wearing, isn't it?
How
you felt about your mother?
No. It's important stuff. And actually, where did you meet? At what point? With whom? Mm-hmm. And how do you know? And can you substantiate that? And it takes the conjecture mm-hmm. out of journalism, which I think is a good thing. It makes it like reporting, mm-hmm. and reporting as opposed to opinion pieces.
But conjecture is part of what you do.
Yeah.
It's part of the magic of all.
Well, and I like to think what I do is different from journalism, and I like to think that, people come to the theatre and expect something different. Very often in in sort of in a Q&A or in a review or whatever, I get taken to task. You know, people have a go at me for, you know, inaccuracy or whatever, and we get into this debate about accuracy and truth and and to what degree, you know, I mean, and very often I think I'm inaccurate. There are inaccuracies in Frost Nixon. Mm-hmm. I mean, the order in which I put the interviews is an inaccuracy.
Huh.
Actually, the Watergate interview came in the middle of the Nixon interviews, but clearly was the dramatic high point. So, as a dramatist, you have a choice. And the phone call, I think, is well documented. That didn't happen.
Mm-hmm.
But I think I'd like to think that the phone call gets to the heart of Nixon's self-destructive urges more accurately than, you know, transcriptions. You know.
Well, I think that's been the experience for a lot of us. I mean, Last King of Scotland was a little less entertaining, I guess, in terms of the fun of it. But something about the Queen and the intimacy of being behind the door of somebody who you feel like you know on some level and you don't. And the same thing with Nixon here, more so than Frost, I think. People are kind of surprised endlessly with Frost Nixon in particular how entertaining it is. They go to the theater or they go to see the movie and they kind of expect something. They kind of know what to expect, but they're not really sure that they're going to have a great time, and they just have a great evening of cinema.
Right. Well, that's nice to hear.
Yeah.
I mean, certainly that was, you know, it was an experience that Michael Grandage, I could tell the way he was directing the piece, you know, when it was first on stage, it was very adrenalized. And we made the decision very early on not to have an interval.
Mm-hmm.
That it could, you know, even at a running time of just fractionally, 1 hour 54, I beg your pardon, right. On a bad night, it went to 1:57, and he would always scream at them, you know. But
faster,
but
faster.
Yeah, yeah. Oh God, it's got very slack. You know that actually it was something that people didn't feel had taken. You know, there can be long 2 hours and fast 2 hours, and that we made the decision halfway through the rehearsal process to absolutely take the interval out.
Was the use of video part of your or the video style?
No, that was one of the great You know, we talked a long time about the close-up and how important the close-up was and what it meant, and we talked about television. And, you know, I at the beginning, like I said, it was never a political play. It was a play about television and journalistic responsibility and the power of the media and the sort of collusion between media and politics. And, you know, it wasn't a Bush metaphor. It wasn't about accountability. It wasn't about, I mean, in many ways, those themes were there, but Grandage and I definitely focused on the television, and so he created this fantastic, you know, well, he didn't, his partner and his designer, Christopher Oram, created this wonderful video wall and anyway, I don't want to.
Well, but it's amazing that in a weird way, I mean, you hear that Ron Howard and Imagine are going to do the film, and you're like, oh, it's Ron Howard and Imagine, and great, they picked up another piece of material, and then you realize who Ron Howard is, and that he is a man of television. You know, that's where he came from. There really couldn't be a more appropriate director to understand that eye.
Funny enough, I didn't think when it came to making the decision about who to sell the rights to. I mean, first and foremost, Ron was somebody that I knew and had a relationship with, because we'd spoken about doing other things. But it was, there were two things that I thought were so important. I'd never thought that Frost Nixon would ever be seen by Americans. Mm. You know, if I'd have thought it would have the life in this side of the Atlantic that it has had, I wouldn't have had the guts to write it. You know, it was definitely a story about an Englishman who got in too deep.
Okay, well, but how do you get intimidated? I don't know that, I didn't know that was, you write a movie about the Queen and her private life and how she felt about Diana. You really would have been intimidated?
Well, there is a way in to writing, to this that isn't about, you know, I mean, for example, we ended up in the publicizing the film at one point in Washington at some august collection of, you know, Watergate historians and the great and the good, and some real legends from the Hill came, and there were lots of bow ties and lots of white hair in that audience. And if anybody told me that I would one day end up on a panel facing these people, I wouldn't have picked up my pen. Never. I mean, never, because it wasn't a play about Nixon for me in any shape or form, and I would have felt completely ill-equipped to take on Nixon. You know, Nixon was absolutely not my trauma, not my generation, not my country. I didn't vote for him. I wasn't let down or betrayed by him. But Frost, I get him. And so, you know, I tried writing The Queen without Blair. And I couldn't. And Stephen Frears said to me, he said, "Oh, don't put Blair in." But I couldn't write it without him. He was my way in. And Frost is my way into Nixon. And in America, of course, all the attention comes to, you know, it's all about Richard Nixon.
So it really is a movie about Frost that has an amazing guest appearance by Nixon.
Correct. Well, I mean, it's not that. It's more of a, it's definitely about an Englishman who completely underestimates the shit he's got into.
Yeah.
And I, you know, and it's a wonderful contrast between this sort of this absurd, almost Austin Powers-like sort of playboy gallivanting around the world on the cocktail bar of a first-class cabin on an airplane, and this sort of, you know, scowling misanthrope and criminal. And so that cocktail interested me, but I was never trying to make my mark in the Watergate business, you know, in the Richard Nixon industry. I wasn't trying to say, you know, Bob Woodward, watch out.
It was an interesting thing that I think both in The Queen and in Frost Nixon, there's something about this person of great power, of once of great power, at least with Nixon, coming to a certain peace, it seems, in the process of going through this experience with who they are and how they fit into the big picture.
Yes, I'm never sure about that. I mean, I hope that we didn't. Something happens in the process of watching a film. I can't quite understand it, and it isn't written. I've always defended Stephen Frears, and I was horrified at the sympathetic response that The Queen got. I mean, you know, that The Queen's main audience should be ladies of a certain age that went to sigh wistfully at her Madge would have horrified us. Similarly with Nixon, I mean, we had no intent. But there's something about the cinema and a darkened room and the empathic connection with villainy. And there's something about villainy that is almost more likable than success. And, you know, in that sense, Frost was a very hard man. He's always been a hard man to like. He's you know, particularly in a country where we loathe conspicuous success. Mm. You know, Frost is, on the one hand, he's a man who's constantly having parties. But on the other hand, he's a man who, you know, has always been satirized and hatcheted a little bit.
So have you developed a relationship with him in the process of all this, or?
You know, it's a polite relationship, but it's a distant relationship. I mean, I really don't like to meet people that I write about. And David did want to stay very close to the project and try and, you know, influence me, and I would prefer to keep my distance.
Yeah, we keep on hearing, you know, he's over at the Four Seasons and he's really old. That's what, you know, it's a strange thing that he actually still exists. It's almost like he's become a fictional character because we haven't really seen him here in this country for a long time.
Right.
He's kind of gone away.
Well, it was an amazing thing that he did, and what, you know, what interested me was that it's morally complex what he did. He paid a criminal, I suppose. I mean, it would in today's money, it would be like offering George Bush $3 million to sit and talk about why he went to Iraq, and then he
Which
also
they would do.
They don't pay that much.
If he would tell the truth, they would pay him that much.
but he wouldn't subject himself to anything because he doesn't need the money.
Yeah,
Richard Nixon was broke, and Frost also offered him 20% of profit participation, which is, you know, it's so unethical. It can't pass for journalism, and yet, you know, in some way, he achieved what the political process failed to achieve.
Well, there's something that's reflective of now in this whole thing. It's certainly, I think, that, you know, where the journalistic business has gone over this period of time, because there's much more pay to play than there was back then.
Right.
To major organizations, you know, there's always that fight between NBC and ABC and CBS about who's going to pay for which interview.
Well, I found when I looked at tapes from that era. People were much more inclined to answer the question that they were asked. And that's, of course, become, you know, that doesn't happen at all anymore. People just, you know, you ask. And there were so many instances when I was researching and I found television footage and particularly actually Mike Wallace, who stalked, who was so loathed what Frost had done that he sort of followed it around a bit like a sort of, you know, like the albatross in the Ancient Mariner. He was just constantly like hovering over it. And And he asked his own bosses, he said, how much did you offer? And the man went, well, you know, I can't really say, how much did you offer? All right, we offered $250,000. And, you know, I mean, they gave answers. Mm-hmm. They gave answers, which nowadays no one would do.
No, it's kind of stunning when you think about it.
Yeah.
But even back then, CBS was offering money for
interview. They did.
So have you met Clinton? Have you palled around in the
I haven't met Clinton in, to a degree that I would call a meeting. I've met him, you know, at a handshake and on one of his fundraisers. And
so is it the piece of history that compels you to want to be writing this? Or I guess you're writing it now? Or
Yeah, I've written it. It's pre-9/11 history, which already feels Jurassic. And riveting as a result. And it was an exciting time. And it's about, you know, listen, it's about the same sort of thing as Frost Nixon's about. It's about England and America, mm-hmm. you know, which I love writing about. And given that it's sort of how I spend my life, really. Well, as an Englishman in America, you know.
But only because you've been so successful at writing about Englishmen and Americans, I guess.
Or Ugandans.
Yes. Do you consider yourself stuck in Hollywood now? Is that your?
No, emphatically not. I come here, I like being here. Mm-hmm. I have a lot of friends here. Mm-hmm. But I don't think it would be good for me to be here for any long time.
So, and how has it changed for you as a writer? I mean, obviously, you now have had a great deal of success, and you're not worried about feeding the kids quite as much as you were maybe a few years ago.
Right.
Has it changed the dynamics of the work at all for you, or is it just more opportunities
It doesn't, because the truth of the matter is, any piece of writing is likely to be better if you write it on spec than if you, you know, take a commission and take notes. I think that's always catastrophic. So there's always still that feeling of, you know, writing something all on your own somewhere for a few months. Mm-hmm. And if anything, you know, if you've been fortunate enough to have any kind of success whatsoever, I find that makes the work almost harder to do. The expectations you have of yourself are slightly higher or more confused. And I would wish success for everybody, but not too much of it.
So you don't really want to win the Oscar, you just want to get nominated? Is that right?
No, with the Queen, the night before the... I think everybody would agree that it was really only ever going to be me or Michael. Only Michael or I had won all the way through that season. And the night before the Oscars, by which time you're so bored of the whole thing anyway. I mean, you want to shoot yourself by the time it gets to February.
On both sides, believe me.
Yeah, of course. I mean, no one, everyone, this is mad collusion and this whole thing. It's like, hasn't this gone on too long? And the night before, you sort of notice that you've become almost against your, you know, better judgment or any desire. You do want to compete in the end. And because you've flown all that way and you've done all that thing and it's turned colleagues into competitors, and it's done, and it's turned, it, the whole thing is unfortunate, really. Yeah. And it, the whole thing is set up to be a blessing, and it's and it ends up being quite difficult. And you know, the only way you can navigate your way through it is by remembering that it is such a business, and that actually it can really help a film like this be seen, and the studio that spent the money needs to get that money back, and that you're a part of that process. But it's very counterintuitive to whatever it was that made you a writer in the first place.
But it's part of your job to stay unconscious of that, I guess.
You have to try.
Yeah, while you're working, you can't really be chasing an award.
Hideous.
What the downright is, yeah.
But I don't, I mean, like I said, Frost Nixon started off with the deepest hopes I had for it, where it would be a... Anyway, I was lying in bed with my wife that night, and I said, do you know what, tomorrow, you know, when the Oscar comes, of course I want to win, but there's a really bad part of me it's a very normal part that wants to win. And then there's another part that knows it would be so much better for me if I didn't, and it would make writing so much easier if I didn't. And so I was perfectly happy not to win. I'm perfectly happy not to win.
You're just happy to be nominated.
Well, the film, the writer's nomination doesn't mean shit.
You can say shit on the internet.
It doesn't mean shit. I mean, you know, the picture would really. I'm not sure I'd dance naked because I wouldn't want to subject anybody to that. But I'd be really thrilled if the picture.
A lot of parties at the chateau could be dancing naked.
Ew.
That's right. You don't want to see Jim Sheridan out there naked either.
You don't see any man over 40 naked.
Ever, 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 ever.
Ever.
So, what was the? Was the casting of this, was Michael Sheen kind of a near lock?
He was a complete lock.
Yeah.
He was absolutely
No, I mean, and not in terms of the movie, in terms of the play in the first place.
Oh, yeah.
Michael's because coming along for the ride.
I said, you know, if it's for Michael to say no to.
Right.
So, you know, I wrote it, and I thought, well, he'd be perfect. And you know, and so I rang him up and said, look, I've written something. And, I mean, there was never any question. Right.
So who said Frank Langella the first time?
The casting director for the Donmar Warehouse.
Mm-hmm.
And she had a woman called Anne McNulty, and she, it was going to be David Strathairn, and he suddenly got the call for Paul Greengrass's film, and then I was personally much more excited about Frank when I'd been given the list of the people that they were going to, and because of Frank's size, and I'd also heard that he was, you know, just this Titan stage actor, and so that made me feel there's something. David Strathairn has quite a light voice, and he's he's not frail man, but he's a slim man,
yeah.
And I felt it would be important just physically for Nixon to be intimidating, I knew that he was a tall man, and Langella's height and presence, I was really excited. So when they said it's Langella, I was personally happier than had they said we'd got.
It really is kind of a Dracula performance in a way. It's like he envelops.
He looks like Brezhnev. He doesn't look like Nixon at all. Well, but there's something remarkable that he does. And
so when's the first time, I mean, you were not as much involved with the rehearsals, but when was the first time you saw the kind of creation come together and realize something truly unique was happening with that?
Well, I think I was too scared. I think that I've never known anything more frightening than opening night of a play.
So you had you seen Langella do Nixon?
Oh, of course. Right. But Frank's process is very different from Michael's. Michael turned up on day one of rehearsals with Frost. Bang. There he was. Off the book, everything.
Mm-hmm.
And Frank took a long, long time. He was very much Frank, and he lowered himself into Richard Nixon, and his method is completely different, and his working process. So Frank wasn't really, and also there was the question of his appearance, because as you know, he doesn't look anything like Richard Nixon, but by the time he became him, and you know, with these really transformative actors, the physiognomy changes in their performance without prosthetics, without. Yeah. Some actors have it in them. I think Phil Hoffman's one, but you know, and Langella's one. They have it. They literally physically transform. I think Helen Mirren did it. If I'd have told you what Helen Mirren didn't have, it was more interesting than what she did have in terms of hair and makeup.
Yeah,
she had almost nothing.
Well, one of the fascinating things seeing Langella on Broadway doing the show, we saw it twice because I wanted to get closer because I'd heard at Donmar that it was. The intimacy of the room.
That was very special at Donmar.
So I made sure to get third row seats the second time around. But to watch him actually leave stage in the dark was one of the most interesting moments for me because the gait and the weight of his shoulders and everything else stayed with him as he kind of limped off into the end of the scene. And that was almost more as much convincing as the, you know, the words flying out of his mouth.
Yeah, and his physical endurance as well. I mean, staying with a play for as long as we did, because they did it for a year and 3 months, I think, almost uninterruptedly. I mean, there were brief hiatuses when they moved theatres. Their stamina and the electricity, when it came to filming it, there were just these crowds of people who just came to watch because they hadn't seen take after take of something. You know, and Ron did many takes.
Right.
And in the entire shoot of Frost Nixon, Ron at the end went up to his sound guy and said, did either of those guys ever at any point in the last 3 months fluff a line? And the sound guy said they did one each. And that was, you know, just the level at which those two, the technical virtuosity of their performances, both on screen and on stage, you just sit back and go, phew.
So you've been through the stage performances, you've been through the move to Broadway, you're making the movie. When you finally see this movie, when Ron showed you the first cut or whatever,
I was in the editing room with Ron a lot.
Oh, you were, okay.
Oh, yeah.
Firstly, actually, I was going to go back to something you said about getting notes. Did you get any notes on your screenplay?
Oh, yeah.
I mean,
oh,
you have to go through that process.
A lot. We changed it quite a lot from the play. I mean, it may be deceptive, but it's sort of a lot changed.
But that was done together? That was the process of working together?
Oh, yeah, it was lovely.
So it was, that was actually great.
Listen, Frost Nixon, the experience, you know, was, you know, I'm screwed now. You know, that was the most, you know, I'd always felt that there had to be disharmony and rancor mm-hmm. to make a halfway decent film. And right. this complete, well, you know, this experience was so life enhancing, not mm-hmm. life shortening.
So when you see it all together, are there any surprises for you? Is it different?
Oh, you mean the movie?
When you finally see the movie put together, yeah.
It's, I think that the play was colder. There's a warmth to the film, and I think that comes from the emotion. I think in the play, some of the ideas were more isolated and distant, and you could maybe admire some of the ideas, but I think in the film, some of the warmth and some of, you know, Ron's very, he's a dignified man who's mature enough. His even-handedness really plays in the film. And you really enjoy, you know, somebody not passing judgment on two men.
Mm-hmm.
And that's quite, I quite like that. So it feels a warmer feeling to me. I think maybe the music helps. I mean, mm-hmm. you know, that makes it.
Yeah.
Hans Zimmer did a great job.
So are you ready to go back to theater, or are you, I mean, you're obviously going back to film right now, but is theater calling? Do you feel like
it would if it would, but I think I would write something. I thought I'd written something that was unadaptable, and mm-hmm. I would like to try and write something that's so theatrical and inherent to its theatre that it's just theatre.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't necessarily want to blur the experiences again, because I think in this one, you know, it was probably quite difficult for some of the people in the original play
right.
who'd done such a wonderful job to find that it then went off and became something bigger, right. you know, somewhere else. And Michael Grandage in particular, who did such a great job, I feel for him now, seeing his achievements in some way almost eclipsed, you know, mm-hmm. by the size of what happens when Hollywood makes a movie and it travels around the world, you know. It's really Grandage's creation, the whole thing.
Is there a touring show of Frost Nixon?
Yes, there are three, I think.
Because, I mean, it's funny, because Frank Langella and I did an interview last year, and we talked about Dracula,
right.
and me remembering seeing him when I was a kid in Florida,
right.
at Miami Beach doing the show, and that wasn't me.
Oh, really?
He never toured with it. He did New York, and he never toured, and people come up to him all the time, remembering when he was touring in it, that he never did. In this case, there are three touring companies going.
There's one in America,
yeah.
I think there's one in Canada.
Mm-hmm.
And if I'm not mistaken, one's about to start in Germany. It's been in Australia.
Because a lot of shows have done a lot better, actually, after the movie's a big hit. Shows like Chicago and Hairspray.
It'd be interesting to see what the effect is.
Yeah, because I think the show does have a life of its own.
Patrick Marber told me, when I first was talking about whether to sell the rights as a film or not, Patrick Marber said, oh, do, it's great for the play.
Because
mm-hmm. He'd had that experience on Closer. I haven't seen it. I still can't quite bring myself to see a version without Frank and Michael, but I do realize, I know that the touring version with Stacey Keach mm-hmm. is going to be in Los Angeles at the time of the Oscars. So if we're asked back, I might go and have a look, and if not, I'll catch it somewhere else.